And now, Dr. Brian Wright reads shit takes from wrestling fans on social media.
Okay, so we got a situation that we had yesterday, and I know it's going to be talked about, so I figured I'd do it since it's up to shit take alley. And this was from a response by Tony Khan, I guess, due to USA Network's X account, posting about the cage match ratings for the Jinder Mahal's Seth Rollins NXT feud they had many, many years ago. But here's what he said. A moral victory for USA is one win more than their world title challenger Jinder Mahal has in the past 364 days, because it's been literally a full year since he won a match. You really put AEW in our place getting Jinder Mahal in a big match on your TV show. Do it more often.
Okay. All right. Let's take a slight pause there. Right. Tony Khan believing that all of this matters is probably still the funniest thing to me over all of this. Like, never mind the knee-jerk reactions from other people that saw this and laughed and got angry or whatever. But the fact that Tony Khan is addressing the Jinder Mahal scenario, the title scenario, as if it's a legitimate belt. And he runs a company with belts. Like,
oh, he's got plenty of them. More than enough.
I just find it so humorous coming from him. Like, if this was, this almost sounded like it came from a parody account. When I first read it, I didn't believe it was real. I didn't believe it was real. I'm
like a tilde somewhere hiding.
Right. All right, who photoshopped this shit? Come on. Like, who put this up there? Was it Tony Khan? I knew it was you, Tony Khan. AEW fan said what? No? Maybe? Okay.
Oh, Christ. Yeah, but no, it was very, very much so real to him.
Oh, I mean, boy. Just
this idea of, like, yeah, well, he hasn't even won a match. Fucking roasted. It's like, do you really think you're helping yourself here at all?
He does. He was very proud of that statement. You could feel the pride behind him when he said, do it more often. Do it again. Like,
the ratings are gonna tank. And you're like, dude, even if half a million people tuned out because they saw Jinder Mahal on the TV, it would still be double the ratings your show was getting.
Dude, it was like when me and you joked the other week. And you were like, oh, yeah, I heard somebody big came back on Monday night. And I'm like, Jinder Mahal. Tony Khan took that seriously. The Rock, who? No, I'm here for Jinder Mahal.
Well, that's it. It's like he wants to dunk on the lowest hanging fruit humanly imaginable at all. It's the same exact thing as, remember when he had his whole little fucking, like, jumping in the air. Yeah, we beat SmackDown for a half an hour one time 3 years ago. And you're like, God, dude, God, it is the lowest hanging fruit. And he can't wait to chomp down on it. But, dude, still to me, the funniest thing about that little tit for tat with the USA.
With the oh, USA, no, there's more. I'll read off the rest. We'll have Brian read off the rest. Don't get too far ahead.
So after a fan, I guess, had said something to him, he decided to clap back with a double standard. 7:30 Hook has a 28-1 career record on winning streak, calls out the champ, a logical challenge sparks online outrage. Jinder has barely lost every single match he's in for the past year. Immediately gets title shot. Where is the rage? AEW Dynamite tomorrow on TBS.
The plot thickens, ladies and gentlemen. The plot thickens.
Oh, yeah. Well, that was it. It's just, you know, it, to him in his mind, in this moment, more people should be like, yeah, Hook. Yeah, Hook. Which, this is how out of sorts that company is at this point. You are pushing somebody who, to the average fan, is being made fun of in lieu of Jinder Mahal. That's how badly you have fucked up. A guy who is almost inarguably maybe one of the lowest, if not the lowest. I don't know if I want to say that. I don't have stats actually in front of me, but like nobody was like perceived going to the lowest building. Yeah. Nobody was buying tickets to see him. And the majority of the coverage of him and people talking about him online was done as a complete irony bro bullshit thing.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, he was not in any way, shape, or form like a high point. He was not over. People were not excited about it. He was a nice idea that was going to pay off on a tour in India, and then Triple H beat him over there anyways. So it was a failure all around, and it kind of acknowledges that.
Right.
But it's pretty goddamn terrible. With all of that said, he still found a way to make you look stupid, and to in a way, too. Poor Hawk. What the this kid, no. This is just...
It's the Julia Hart syndrome. It's Julia Hart syndrome at the media scrum. Julia Hart had to be there when he was getting hit with all those hard-hitting Jericho questions. And she's just like, can I get out of here? Can I please go? This has nothing to do with me. My match is over. I'm contractually obligated to be here at this scrum. I don't want to deal with this. Like,
there's this girl that's like barely drinking age that, and she's sitting next to this 40-year-old man wearing a silly costume, defending a 50-something-year-old man, because the only reason why Tony Khan has not actively picked Chris Jericho up and thrown him fully under a bus is because Tony would have to follow suit. That is the only.
Well, it would also make him it would also make him a huge hypocrite too. It would actually it wouldn't make him a hypocrite. It would actually make him honest. Yeah, the fact that he hasn't done anything about Jericho or even pushed further into it, I mean, considering his allegations against Vince and stuff, like, I don't know, dude.
He's not doing anything about it because he also did a very wrong thing.
Right. He covered it up.
Tony Khan covered the fuck up.
Jimmy snuck at the body. Right. No.
Yeah. Sure. So if we have this situation of, you know, Tony Khan should have done something about it. He can't, because then he himself is admitting guilt. He's saying, I covered this shit up.
You know what, though, Joe? Maybe we're misunderstanding. I'd like to believe that the conversation between him and Jericho went something like this. Hey, Jericho, did you do anything? Nope. Okay, Jericho, love you, man. See you on Wednesday. Okay, that's great. Investigation concluded, you know? I'd like to think that he's just... that low bar that he's just, you know, his investigation skills are closer to being like Scooby-Doo rather than, you know, like Matlock.
You know what? I'm this is what I'm more than likely guessing how this situation played out. And I'm just, you know, for those that are listening to this now, just for your own sake, just close your eyes and just paint this picture in your head. Okay. Jericho's in the suite of some hotel that Tony Khan had paid for. Okay.
Zach and Cody? Oh, sorry. Never mind.
Did I say Cody Khan?
Yeah, maybe. Go on.
Oh, I don't know. Tony Khan is paid for. All right. Tony Khan gets a frantic call from a very, very inebriated Chris Jericho. Okay. Saying, I don't know what's going on. I don't know what her problem is. That just get over here. Tony Khan makes his little way over to Chris Jericho's suite. He opens the door. Jericho's in a pair of fucking leather pants and a scarf for some reason at 2 o'clock in the morning, just reeking of mid-tier fucking vodka, maybe Grey Goose. And Jericho goes into his diatribe saying, I don't know what I did wrong. I don't even know what she just got real upset. And it doesn't even make sense, man. I thought she was feeling me. And just listing off platitudes, saying I've never done a thing wrong in my life. And Tony Khan just sits there with that same vacant Johnny got his gun fucking look on his face that he's had anytime anybody's mildly confronted him with anything other than blind praise.
Yeah.
So then that turns into, oh gosh, I'll give her a call. I'll give her a call then, Chris. And he calls her up and brings her over and says, we'll talk about it in the morning. And the lawyers come and maybe she's real upset. He fucking cuts the check and it's just like, oh, okay. Well, you guys should probably, couldn't you see Tony Khan in this situation? No. Now, still picture, close your eyes, picture. Couldn't you see Tony Khan making them sign the NDAs and make them sign the whole thing? And then Tony Khan asking her for a hug and then asking them to like shake or give each other a hug and let it all just be bygones. Right, couldn't you just see him being that fucking clueless?
Well, because he deals with everything with money. And if money can't solve the problem, then the fear of his lawyers, the fear of what his money can do is the repercussions of it. So that's the thing, is you either take the money and smile, or you don't take the money and realize that the money can crush you whenever the fuck the money wants to. And that's the problem with Nepo babies. That's the problem with billionaires. And that's why, once again, Tony Khan is on his way to becoming a supervillain. I'm telling you.
Oh, yeah.
It's going
to
happen.
Yeah, he's getting the nuke. He's going to space.
All right. Let's continue.
And, you know, he said that about the win-loss record, and some people actually posted some facts that Tony Khan is guilty for this, too. From Patrick the Heel at Patrick the Heel on X, he puts Jinder Mahal is 2-8 in his last 10 televised WWE matches. Daniel Garcia was 3-7 in his last 10 televised AEW matches going into his title match with MJF. Book Daniel Garcia better, by the way. Y'all do the same dumb shit too, for fuck's sakes. Exactly. He also points out Ethan Page was 1-9 on AEW TV match heading into his match with MJF when he just randomly beat him on or fought him on Collision. And in closing to all this, it's really tough to book around lifetime win-loss records. It was damn near impossible. And if you care about a win-loss records in wrestling, it's just dumb at this point. All right, take care, wrestling suit motherfuckers.
So here's the real thing, though, is that was Tony Khan's baby. His big fucking thing with AEW, if you guys remember when it first started, was wins and losses matter. Wins and losses matter. And they used to, and they haven't done it for a while, I don't think. I don't recognize it. But I think they still have it on the title card or the actual name card. But it was to the point where it was like there was rankings. There was actually, they would show the rankings of their wrestlers based upon wins and losses per week. And then they would add in things like dark and light and elevator and all that shit into the fucking the matrix of numbers that they had. And so they tried to get the fandom on board with the idea that, you know what, these numbers matter. And it's the whole Goldberg shtick all over again. It's like, yeah, what is he, 400 and 0? Yeah, sure. It doesn't fucking matter. Just tell people whatever the fuck they want. Like, he would go week to week. It's like, you didn't have 100 matches this week. Ah, nobody gives a shit. You know, like, numbers don't matter. The only thing that matters in professional wrestling is the perception of who you want as champion, is the perception of the way the fans receive the talent that you're pushing. You can tell them that they've won 84 matches and lost none, and it'll be just as good as if they had 85 or 84 exhibition matches on Dark. Like, it doesn't fucking matter.
Right. And ultimately, this whole idea of it just being like, they have this record and they have a this, that, or the other thing. You know what? If you have one TV show, then that's kind of one of those situations where it's like, yeah, sure, the wins and losses can matter because people are watching one TV show.
Right.
That's all. They're just getting that taste of it. They're seeing that person, you know, whatever it might be, the two times a month or three times a month where they may or may not wrestle for long or for short periods of time. So, yeah, if they see you as a perpetual loser, that fucking matters. But when there was a point where we had dark elevation, fucking Dynamite, whatever, Saturday show, there was like six TV shows, then what they didn't even realize was like that record makes it mean even less.
Right.
That makes it way, way fucking less. There's a reason why when people talk about, you know, win-loss records in sports, a win and a loss in an NFL season means a hell of a lot more than a win or a loss in an NBA season. Why? Because there's fucking four times the amount of games.
Right. Right.
That's why. And in that situation where somebody might go, like, you know what? You're going to look like a goddamn fool if your team is 5-11 and you're like, yeah, the playoffs are still in sight for them.
Right.
They're, you know what? I think they might still be able to do it. You're going to look goofy as fuck. But if we're talking about a pro wrestling show where people are having literally dozens of untelevised matches at any given point, then does it really matter if it's like, oh, well, it turns out they're 28-7.
Yeah.
I didn't see fucking 30 of those matches. So who cares?
Right. Doesn't matter. I was just saying, this is one of his pet things. You know, I see Pac-Man saying it was pushed by JR at first. I don't know. Tony Khan first mentioned it in 2019. So I don't know if it was JR's idea at first. I can't see JR being a guy like that, though, either. I mean, the total side note, I just can't see JR, of all people, thinking that win-loss records matter.
Right. No. JR might think that, like I said, once again, if this is somebody that gets featured on television and that's it, they got the one show and they seem, you know, consistently as a guy that wins or somebody that consistently loses. Yeah, maybe. But yeah, when there's five TV shows and 70% of their audience doesn't see 90% of the matches, then yeah, it doesn't fucking matter.
Right.
It really comes down to that. It does not matter to those people. But still, just even all this talk about it being like, well, this person was 3-7, or this person was 1-9, or this person was, it was like, how do you make them look on the TV?
Right.
You know what I mean? Course. Like, it's like, Hook is 75-1. And it's like, yeah. And he looks like a dipshit on the TV.
Yeah.
He's a dipshit, skinny kid. It's
because he can't build the perception up, though. That's what really matters. Right. That's what we're saying, though, is at the end of the day, the wins and losses never mattered. So the fact that Tony Khan is all up at arms because of Jinder's win-loss record and his title fucking contention, it's silly. It's silly for believing that it matters. It's silly for believing that the belts are real. It's silly to believe that Jinder's actually fighting for this moment. Like, he's been working real hard behind the scenes, guys. Like, what does he think he's doing? Jinder Mahal's chasing chickens around like Vince? Like, what the fuck? It's such a weird perception, because does that mean that Tony Khan has those same perceptions of Hook? That, oh, well, Hook told me he was chasing chickens again. I was like, well, goddamn, kid, let's get you a belt. You know,
isn't the last time we saw Samoa Joe, he was like in a fairly big match, he was losing to CM Punk, who's not even in the company anymore.
Oh, yes, of course.
So it's just like this idea of picking and choosing, like, huh, that's the next person that should be the champion. Huh, that's the next person that should be a big challenger. It's
Brian,
like you don't get to have both. Well, no, it's like you don't get to have both. Like, pretend that you give a fuck about the records. And then do dumb shit like that.
Brian asks, he's like, but if you can't believe in the work, what do you get behind? Or what do you believe in? Well, the story. I mean, if you can't believe in the work, then you've done a piss poor job. Try again. Do something different. Like, if it doesn't work, that happens in wrestling all the time. Jinder Mahal doesn't work. You know what you have to keep doing? Keep throwing him up against the wall or fire him. Like, right. what do you do? Oh, well, it didn't work this time, guys. I guess I'll just go sit up my 4-year contract. Okay. So, you know, like, what the fuck? Like, it's just, and I know he's asking this out of curiosity because of the way that he's presenting the question. And I'm not trying to downplay your question at all, Brian. I'm just saying, like, you just keep trying. Some people have gone through how many gimmick changes in a career? You know, it's, you keep trying until something works, or you keep trying until you're done with them.
Right. Right. Well, there's also this idea, too, where when it comes to the wins and losses, right, always winning or always losing one way or the other, usually always losing or losing more consistently.
Yeah. Yeah.
That doesn't always have to be tied into your connection and the love that you get from an audience.
R-Truth is a wonderful example of that. Does anybody actually track or care about R-Truth's win-loss record?
Yeah, right. Why would you feature Ron Killings on television? Right. His win-loss record, like, you take out a monocle. It's like, you're a moron. You're a fucking moron. If the guy comes out and reads the back of a fucking cereal box, people are laughing and fucking having a great time.
Dude, they gave R-Truth a fucking timeless vignette about why he was always been a part of Judgment Day, which was fucking hilarious on Raw this week. I was dying of laughter. How he was popped out at birth and he was telling the doctor he was going to be a Judgment Day. It was just stupid as all fucking hell, because they played the real deep drama music in the background, and there was the crescendos, and there's Truth talking in all seriousness, delivering this like this is all honest to goodness. And it was great. And it was fucking great. And I laughed so hard. And the entire time I thought of, I'm like, well, you know, R-Truth really doesn't care about his win loss record, does he? He doesn't really care about that. R-Truth is only out there because he's so entertaining to people. And whether he's having a match against Miz or, you know, with Judgment Day or whatever, it doesn't matter. He's there for entertainment purposes. But the Tony Khan shit is just out of control. It really is. I mean, it's another case where, Joe, we've had to agree with people like Bubba Ray Dudley, who is literally going on Busted Open Radio saying, Tony Khan, put down your fucking phone, you idiot. There's so many people turning against you right now. Stop it. You're looking like a buffoon. And it's like, this is coming from Ray. This is coming from Bubba. He makes sense. He's totally right. Like, usually Bubba has some fucking obscure opinions about shit. He really does. But it's weird when you reach this point, when you're looking at the head of the number two promotion in the United States, and it doesn't matter what side of the coin you're on, everybody's looking at you the same way, like, what the fuck did you say?
Right. Why are you doing, like, not even just that, but also, why are you doing this?
Right.
What are you getting from this? And the answer is pretty much absolutely nothing. The fact that USA Network, but
he's embarrassing the business. He's embarrassing the business because he's a guy in control of these people. He's a guy in responsible for so many fucking paychecks. And this is the way he acts. If anything, he makes WWE look bad by comparison, because they'll look at Tony Khan and go, well, no wonder you guys are doing good. Look at your competition.
Well, that's also, you know, this is one of those things that happened in wrestling for a really long time.
Yeah.
That is not so much so a conversation because of the idea of just like everybody can be a part of the show. And I know this is like a concept that people like Cornette and fucking whomever, old timer guys, have beat to death. But there's a reason why people back in the day wouldn't just let anybody and everybody in, because you let the fucking clowns in. And when you let the clowns in, people start to look and go, this is boots, trunks, and a ring. And they can't tell. Sometimes you just don't tell the difference. From just a regular person might not be able to tell the difference. Do you know what I mean? Where they're looking and they're going, wait, Randy Orton, Daniel Garcia. Well, they're both wrestlers and they're wearing tights. This must be the same thing. And you're like, no. No, it's not at all. It's not even close to the same fucking thing. But to a regular everyday person, they might make that mistake. It's the same thing as, you know, for years and years.
But that separates the fans, though, too, because now those fans that are still having this parasocial relationship with Tony Khan also look silly. Like, the smart ones have already fucking punched their ticket. They're like, there's something wrong here. Gotta go. You know, I'll watch the shows, but I'm not fucking standing for this company anymore. And that's what I'm noticing. Nobody's saying that the wrestlers are all of a sudden bad. Nobody's saying that the matches are all of a sudden bad, right? Like, some of them are just bad. But it's not even a reflection on the talent. It's a reflection on what pro wrestling looks like. Right. Do you see what I'm saying? Like, the talent are still going to be talented for the audiences that gather to see them. But Tony Khan makes the whole industry look a fool by having back and forth tweets with the USA Network, by having meltdowns about random records that don't mean shit, about being a guy who's in charge, and the person that you compare yourself to, Vince McMahon, is such a alpha, such a Chad above you, that we can't even see the shadow of where your daddy dropped his seed, because that's how low you are. It's just,
you're not even, this guy is not a good person, and people are still looking and going, yeah, but I take him.
And that's where it looks silly. The people that are fucking still going for him, that's where it really looks bad. I think Tony Khan's going to take it with him. That's what I'm telling you, supervillain shit, dude. He's going to take the wrestling industry with him. When AEW goes down, he's going to make everybody look like an asshole for even fucking enjoying the shows. Well,
Mitch, probably one of the most frustrating things about just the way that this company is ran and how this has played out over the past half a decade. One of the most, like, just, if anything, infuriating things to me is the fact that a lot of people are going to watch this and they're never going to take away the fact that you should look at how Tony Khan has done this and gain the knowledge that, hey, this ain't that fucking easy.
Right.
All right. To where, for all the things I can say about this dude, clearly has fucking something very wrong with him. You know, more than likely has a social disorder, at least in my opinion. You know, he's got a lot going on. Right. But the idea that you sit there and go, well, I watch it so I can just do it. It's like, no, because this guy was given.
Think it, dream it, do it. Think it, dream it, do it. Think it, dream it, do it.
Well, it's like this fucking kid had the moon, the stars, the sun, everything, every opportunity to make this work. And he fucking couldn't. And it drives me crazy to think that a lot of people, like I said, that are watching this and they're still going around with like big opinions and big heads and big egos and thinking like, oh, I know so much about, did you read my cage fucking whatever site? What's the site? Cage Match fucking thing, yes, that Tony Khan was all sweating his dick about. Yeah. Like, do you read my review of it and let me do this? Like these people, I'm like, you're not that fucking smart. You're just not. You do not know what the fuck you're talking about.
Right.
And the way that we know now, there was a multi-hundred-million-dollar project to show that you're not that fucking smart is one man named Tony Khan. Because he's you. He is fucking you. He is you. And he went and did what you would love to do, and he fell flat on his fucking face. But that won't be what is taken away from it. What will be taken away from it is there are people out to sabotage him, and there are just people who are haters, and they themselves are the fault. They are the mistake. They are the ones that have fucked up. I'm like, no, you're supposed to fucking, it's the job of a company to provide something worth buying, seeing, watching, whatever the fuck you want to say. Right.
Right.
And it's your job as a consumer to call it out when it sucks. And they're supposed to look and go, yeah, that's okay. I see why that's a mistake. Let's try to work on that. It's not supposed to be this thing where they're supposed to just blindly do whatever the fuck they want to do under the guise of making you happy. You're supposed to bark like a seal. Then when they fuck up massively, you make excuses for them. This isn't your boyfriend. Tony Khan's not your fucking boyfriend. He's not your friend. He's not your girlfriend. He's not your family member. If he does a shitty fucking job and waste hundreds of millions of dollars, you should have the right to dunk on him. Especially when this is a guy that for the past half a dozen years has done everything he could to sick fucking people on anybody that's disagreed with them. So suck a fat dick. Go fuck yourselves. Yeah. You know, like, eat shit. Like, I'm so done with him and these fucking people. It's embarrassing.
Well, you know what? Everybody, take some time. Watch some WWE. Catch up on some Raw and some SmackDown. Seriously, the AEW train is just spiraling out of control.
Follow WrestleSoup on Twitter at WrestlingSoup. Like and subscribe to WrestlingSoup on YouTube. And check out the Discord for live chat during the shows at discord.gg/WrestlingSoup. Check out and subscribe to the shows on Apple, Amazon, iHeartRadio, Spotify,
and more.
Oh, God, we smell so...